Welcome students. Today we are going to study the Renaissance and Elizabethan, and as a carryover of the Italian Renaissance. The meaning of Renaissance is a reawakening into the knowledge which existed in the past. The past being the Greek, classical Greek, and the classical Rome, study of antiquity, etc. It was a period which brought about profound changes in the philosophical outlook of the people of Europe, and they took greater interest in their antiquity, in their heritage, as was there in the Greek and Roman time, as opposed to what the church had taught them. Humanism was actually the philosophical background or backbone of this movement of Renaissance. The potential of the individual achievement stipulated that the human beings, the rational human beings, were capable of everything which was true and everything which was good. In the 14th century, Renaissance began in Italy, and it carried on till about the 17th century. And over this long period, it made an impact not only on the scholarship, but also on literature, art, science, everything. The development of printing press in Germany meant that the Renaissance propagated, spread like wildfire through Europe. It was an impulse by which the entire medieval understanding of what the world is about gets changed into the modern world propagates. And this impulse originated in Italy. The characteristics of Renaissance actually meant that people were intensifying their scientific, their geographical, their classical scholarship to a point which was unthought of so far. And there was an immense faith on the potential of man, the individual man as he existed in this world. And it also asserted that the religious life is not the most important thing in about life. The secular life, which involves appreciation of beauty, appreciation of other senses, has tremendous meaning in human life. The Renaissance is actually emphasis on the life of the present. Now, there was tremendous enthusiasm. The Renaissance men and the Renaissance women studied Greek literature with dedication and love and utter enthusiasm. Every year they found new library work, they found new art volume, they found some relic of the Roman or classical Greek art left over somewhere. They discovered Aristotle and Plato. It's not as if the medieval Europe did not know about Aristotle and Plato. But the philosophy was understood and appreciated all over again. Similarly, the plays of Sophocles, Aristophanes, Euripides came into existence and reread, reinterpreted. This word human, the word human became actually the essence of Renaissance. And the humanist is the title they gave themselves. And because they were interested in anything which dealt with the human existence in this life. We will first look at the Italian Renaissance and why, of all the European countries, the Renaissance had to be started in Italy. Now, Italy had a very convenient geographical location. If you look at Italy perched on Mediterranean Sea, it used to connect the rest of Europe with the Byzantine Empire and the Arab world as a trade route. This trade route allowed them to connect the Arab thought and Byzantine thoughts to rest of the Europe. And as the trade progressed, as the trade flourished, we find that some of the city-states of Italy, like Florence, like Venice, like Milan, and like Rome, became exceedingly wealthy. There was enough of money for the merchant class to want to compete with each other to patronize art, sculpture, music, and any form of scholasticism. There is another reason why these four regions also became the cradle and not any other place. Now, it so happened that the Ottoman Turks were constantly attacking the Byzantine Empire. Finally, the capital of Byzantine Empire, Constantinople, fell in the hands of the Turks. And fearing that the Turks, with their sensibilities, will destroy everything which has been so far existing of the Greek and Roman literature and culture and drama and art, the scholars and of antiquity living in Constantinople wrapped all of that up and began to move westward. The wealth and the treasure of these cities facilitated their settlement in these countries. And we also find the patronage of these rich city-states, the merchants, who construction of grand cathedrals as in Florence, or set up competitions so that one sculptor and two sculptors presented ideas of grand structure and finally chose the winner to assign the work to build a new church, a cathedral or a mansion or any public work of art. Therefore, the architects became a very important part of the Renaissance in this period. The artists also, whenever they were encouraged to paint and whenever they were given a commission by a wealthy patron, developed new technique, giving the work of art more lifelike quality. Therefore, the three-dimensional image of human form came into existence as opposed to the medieval one, that of the two-dimensional form. The first important painter of Italian Renaissance was Bondone. He invented the perspective drawing, and it was taken forward by Tommaso Guidi, who is better known as Masaccio, the messed up one. Masaccio also was the first man who painted nude pictures of man and woman. From Masaccio, Botticelli learned this art of nude painting, giving it a certain different dimension in his work called Birth of Venus. And in Florence, for example, the Medici family, particularly Lorenzo Medici and Cosimo Medici, patronized Ghiberti, who constructed St. Paul's Cathedral, and Brunelleschi, another sculptor who designed the dome of this cathedral. He combined existing modern trends of architecture with the trends which was in the style of ancient Rome and bringing about a completely new architectural form which we can call today safely the Renaissance architecture. Now, all the artists whose names we know, whether it is Raphael or it is Michelangelo or it's Ghiberti or it is Brunelleschi, possibly the most influential man of this period as an artist, or to call him an artist is limiting him, the Renaissance man is Leonardo da Vinci. You know him as the painter who painted Mona Lisa, or the famous Last Supper. But Leonardo was not just a painter. He was interested in engineering. He was interested in study of anatomy, botany, architecture, physics, meteorology. He drew a diagram of how an aeroplane can fly. His curiosity and fascination for everything which is around him about man makes him actually the finest example of a Renaissance spirit. Background of the English Renaissance. In England, we find that the Renaissance most greatly impacted the theatre. The theatre as well as the literature. So, when man began to believe in the potential of individual accomplishment in literature, geographical discovery, art, political life, they began to also encourage the artistic expression which looked after and nourished these talents. Now, if you look at the England as it existed, it was not really considered a very, very erudite kind of a nation. English were always thought of lacking in culture, refinement, education, etc. But we find that in England, the Renaissance started around the time when the War of Roses put the Tudor dynasty into power, roughly around the towards the end of the 15th century. The Renaissance style ideas, etc., however, came into England in its flowering state much later. It is only in the reign of Elizabeth, Queen Elizabeth I, that we find that full-fledged flowering of the Renaissance. The English Renaissance differed from the Italian Renaissance in many ways. One for one, the Italian Renaissance is more about art and sculpture. English Renaissance, there is no specific emphasis on sculpture or art to be seen. It is more literature and theater. There is a lot of poetry and a lot of drama which actually expressed the Renaissance ideals in England. This is so because that in England already there was a tradition of literature, vernacular literature, which already had been existent since the time of Chaucer, who had been writing in native English. And there were about 20,000 different publications in England happening, being circulating, people reading about it. It was also another time when the Church of England was created. Henry VIII requested the Pope Clement for a divorce, which when it did not come through, declared that English Church was no longer subservient to the Papal Church in Rome, and new Church of England was established. Protestantism came, and this Protestantism also found its expression in literature. We are now going to discuss about the Renaissance prose development in England, and in this context we'll study about the university wits. But first, let us begin with, as I said, Geoffrey Chaucer, who had already started writing in English as a medium of writing rather than Latin, although there was a whole lot of work being still written in Latin. Contemporaries to Geoffrey Chaucer was William Langland, who had written Piers Plowman, Thomas Malory, who had written Motor de Arthur, John Gower, who was also writing in English. However, the first impact was registered naturally by men who went to the British universities, mainly Oxford and Cambridge. These men came to be known as the university wits. They were repository of all learning, and when they became aware that in Italy there was something happening like a rebirth of knowledge which concentrated on classical learning, some of them studied the revival, and some of them actually traveled to Italy to learn from the Italians, to personally examine all the manuscripts which had arrived from Constantinople, and to learn with the prominent Greek scholars who had immigrated from the Byzantine Empire. Now, some of these scholars were William Grocyn, Thomas Lencare, and John Collett. When they returned from Italy to their native country, they began the teaching of Greek in Oxford. One of the scholars who had come to England to benefit from this learning of Greek is Erasmus. He had come from Netherlands. The Dutchman Erasmus learned in the universities in England and went on to write the book called The Praise of Folly, which according to a lot of critics is possibly the best expression in literature of the Renaissance spirit. If we look at other scholars like Sir Thomas More and Sidney, who came a little later, we will find that the literature at this period was constantly reinventing itself by looking into the past and bringing about some kind of a cultural contribution into the contemporary writing. Now, there was the most important work of literature done in this period in England is by Sir Thomas More, who wrote Utopia. Utopia is actually about the ideal government, which Thomas More shows existed in a particular island, which is an ideal republic, implying, therefore, that what existed in England at that point in time is not the ideal government. Similarly, the next book which became very famous was Francis Bacon's Novam Organum, and which is also again written in Latin. But that is not to say that native English was not being written in. We have Arcadia by Sidney, which is written in English. And we have Laws of Ecclesiastical Polity by Hooker, which was also written in English. But it is noteworthy that at this stage, the English that is being seen in literary work of art is not the English of the common day speech, the one that people spoke. They were more strongly influenced by the Latin rather than the Greek language. So that is how the prose writing started in England in the Elizabethan Renaissance. Next, we are going to talk about the poetry in Elizabethan Renaissance period. Now, Chaucer had started writing poetry in English way back about 200 years before Shakespeare did. But after Chaucer and some of the followers of Chaucer, the English poetry actually slumbered, went dead. There was no further writing happening. And then suddenly we find two new poets who wrote in years close to Chaucer, but were published much later, only when Queen Elizabeth was crowned around 1557. We find that their poems started getting published. These two poets wrote more delicately, more dignified kind of verse, and one of them was Sir Thomas Wyatt and other is Henry Howard, the Earl of Surrey. Now, both these aristocratic writers of poetry, they were both born into nobility and very closely related to the crown monarchs of England. They were pioneers of a kind of new poetry in England. If we look at the work that they produced, we find that Wyatt was writing sonnets which were exactly Petrarchan in their presentation. Now, Petrarch was the Renaissance poet who had discovered sonnet writing. Sonnet is nothing but a 14-line poem with a certain rhyme scheme, and this poem became extremely popular in England around the time when Queen Elizabeth was the monarch of England. Sir Thomas Wyatt, who had travelled to Italy on state work because he was ambassador in Italy for England, as I already said that he was an important enough person and he was related to the monarch of England, he had learnt and adopted the style of Petrarch into writing the sonnet. After Wyatt, Henry Howard, Earl of Surrey, also imbibed the same Petrarchan spirit but developed on it to write more refined kind of sonnet writing, which can actually be said to have generated the finer sonnets of later writers like Sidney or even William Shakespeare. Why it is the person who introduced sonnet writing into England, then Earl of Surrey is the person who introduced the blank verse. Blank verse is the verse which does not have an end rhyme. It is run on line. Most of Shakespearean plays much later got written. And not only Shakespeare, but even Christopher Marlowe practiced blank verse. Wyatt had written a huge body of sonnets. We find that Henry Howard's writing is much better crafted. It has a greater delicacy in its presentation. Apart from Surrey and Wyatt, we do not find a continuation of poetry, this kind of poetry writing in anyone until the next batch of writers appear much later, about 1560 onwards. So we have Philip Sidney, Edmund Spenser, and lastly William Shakespeare. Philip Sidney wrote the sonnet sequence called Astrophel and Stella. Now Astrophel and Stella itself is also Petrarchan in its theme. Astrophel is the man who worships the star, and Stella obviously means the star. So this sonnet sequence is again Petrarchan, where an unattainable lady love is being addressed by the poet. This was Sidney's work. Edmund Spenser went on to write The Faerie Queen. The Faerie Queen became so popular in Elizabethan court that Edmund Spenser was made the poet laureate in Elizabeth's time. It is said that Faerie Queen, which talks about a female knight, is actually reflecting the queen and her qualities in the poem. It is built to please the monarch. And lastly, we will find that Shakespeare writing his sonnets. Shakespeare's sonnets are possibly the best sonnets that English literature ever produced. Next, we are going to look at the drama during English Renaissance. The English drama in the middle of the 16th century is the first great impact of Renaissance visible in form of literature. England was always very rich in the culture of play. There was liturgical play, there was mystery play, there were miracle plays, there were morality plays. We've already had a first English tragedy called Gorboduc, written by Norton and Sackville. We've also had Ralph Royster Oyster, which was a comedy which was written by Udall. These were very much imitations of the Roman writing. In fact, it is unfortunate that most of the dramatists in England ignored the Greek influence. They did not take into consideration the work of Sophocles, Aeschylus, Euripides, or the comedian Aristophanes. Instead, they all concentrated on Roman dramatists like Plautus, Terence, etc. However, we find that there were playwrights who were also university wits like Lilly, Nash, then Green, then Kidd, who took a kind of a independent spirit which is not tied to any of the classical forms. They were very, very native in England. They expressed very native thoughts and they expressed the essence of very native feelings. However, their plays remain very much deeply influenced by Latin Renaissance. They were all fired by the Renaissance idea of the human capability, how man is the center of it all, and how all the dramatics show that they have acquired Renaissance knowledge, the geographical knowledge, the scientific knowledge, entirely amalgamated in their play and presented before the spectators. One man at this stage stands out brilliantly apart from the rest of them, and that is Christopher Marlowe. Christopher Marlowe is a university wit, and he is considered as a true child of the Renaissance. Because in his place, for the first time, we find that he has incorporated the blank verse which Henry Howard as a poet had brought in to English poetry. Now, he was also writing at a time when the Elizabethan drama had taken stage after stage of development, and it was waiting for one final moment of attaining the glory. And Christopher Marlowe was not going to let that go by him. He was an immense genius, and he was challenged and thrilled by the ideas, the scientific ideas, the geographical ideas which existed around him at this time, and he felt titillated enough to write and present them on the stage. So we have a play like Dr. Faustus, which talks about the devil and how Dr. Faustus, and a great scholar, actually sacrifices his soul to the devil for some flesh and blood attainment in this real life. He signifies the Renaissance spirit because he does not think about the afterlife. The afterlife has been given away to the devil and for the pleasure of the life which we are living today. He had also gone on to write Jew of Malta, Edward II. Each one of his plays were the great expression of the Renaissance individuality. The Renaissance thought that the man is the most important, and attention to man's life today is more important than the attention to a life after death. Now, moral dilemma of the Renaissance man, where he should actually follow what the medieval church had taught him, that work for the life after death, or to follow what the revival of classical learning is exposing to him, that this life in its totality is important and we must devote in making qualitative improvement in this life. This moral dilemma also became many of Marlowe's subject matter. As I said, that Dr. Faustus is about a scientist. He contributed so immensely to drama that he left us with characters who were rounded up for the first time, fiery characters, and characters who actually strike as real on the stage. And he paved the way, I think, for the next great genius who succeeded him. Although Christopher Marlowe died an untimely death because he was killed in a tavern brawl at a very tender age, and the next great poet who possibly is the greatest the world has ever seen, that William Shakespeare, coming in and taking over the London stage and producing play after play of great Elizabethan drama charged by the spirit of the Renaissance. Next, we go on to study Shakespeare and the end of Renaissance in England. Now, William Shakespeare in English language stands in this period as a poet, a dramatist, and a playwright who has hitherto been unsurpassed in English literature. He was a dramatist who had genius to create characters with universal perspective. Now, he took subjects from Greco-Roman stories, definitely, but he merged it with the native stories, and his plays were influenced by some of the factors which were essentially Elizabethan in their nature. First of all, he was influenced by work of other dramatists in England like Marlowe, Thomas Kyd. Secondly, he was also influenced by the tradition of medieval drama like moralities and the medieval plays. He was also influenced by Seneca's work. But Shakespeare took all these writing styles, put it together and amalgamated it to bring out something which was essentially his own, which was essentially human in character. If you look at Shakespeare's work, I think Hamlet best expresses his Elizabethan spirit. The dilemma of Hamlet is the dilemma of the Elizabethan man. Shakespeare does not conform to the unity of time, place, or nor does he conform to the classical rules that there should be no comedy character inside a tragedy or no tragic character inside a comedy. He breaks the entire mode of classical plays, and his plays therefore will juxtapose the public with private. The kings are there in the comedies, there are clowns in tragedies, and the society at that point in time, the Elizabethan society, enabled Shakespeare, gave him the freedom to do this in his plays. And he also managed to speak very freely, criticizing the monarchs. He gave his monarchs, the kings in the history plays, or in the King Lear, and the king in Hamlet, the manners of the real man, making them more realistic characters, characters with whom the spectators could relate to. Unfortunately, once Shakespeare's finished writing his plays, the last play that he wrote was Tempest. It's a tragic comedy. It coincided with the closing down of theatre. It is because it was at this point in time the Puritans took over the governance of becoming powerful in governance of the country. And the Puritans did not like the playwright or the playwriting as a mode, because most of the playwrights had their patrons in the royalties or the aristocrats. So in 1642, the London theatres were all closed. And with that, we are going to wrap up this lesson on Elizabethan literature as part of the Renaissance development in Italy as well as in England. Thank you for being with me.